As Lesser said, I'm from the National Museum of Denmark, and I got a PhD project on something called the Head Collection. And at some point, it became apparent to me that there probably was a lot of jadeite artifacts in the collection. So I had to try to find out if that was true or not, because it had implications, as both Sebastian and Alice said before. Unfortunately, most of the jade, or well, fortunately, most of the artifacts, they're quite have an old collection history. And we see a picture here from the most significant part of the collection history, the Danish-Dutch archaeological expedition in 1923. This was quite a long expedition, 9 months long. It went both to the Dutch Antilles, the former Danish US Virgin, now US Virgin Islands, and Dominican Republic, and Puerto Rico. And they had 9 months, and they sent back 22 tons of materials to the National Museum. So it's quite a significant collection, size-wise. And I had to split it up a little bit to focus on certain areas. And that was where the jade became important, in my opinion. But I quickly realized that this I couldn't do on my own. So, because I'm pretty much the only Caribbean archaeologist in Denmark. There's one more who was looking into ancient DNA. So I quickly went to Leiden to get some help, and to Amsterdam to get more help. And so some of the slides will be a little bit similar, and I'll just briefly skip them if we've seen them before. The expedition's leader was a very brilliant archaeologist called Gudmund Hatt. And I don't know if it's this guy, or the one taking the photography here. But I know that this is his wife, who was also an archaeologist, one of the first female archaeologists in Denmark. And her handwriting is a lot better than his, which is an advantage. and then there was the Dutch anthropologist, Jocelyn de Jong, which is a big name in Dutch anthropology and archaeology as well. They went over, they did this expedition, and had, in fact, posed the first chronology for the pre-Columbian Caribbean. A chronology that, in many ways, still is intact. Of course, it's been refined, but it's still intact in many ways. They excavated more than 35 different places and surveyed the same number, so approximately 70 different places from the expedition. And then we had a lot of donations by Danish traders, officials, ambassadors, and whatnot, that has also been put into the collection. So a very varied collection history. This map is pretty much what we've seen from Sebastian and others before. We see the different known source areas, and then there's one hyperfaced, ferrized source area down here. And I put it in not so certain terms, because we don't really know where it is. And then we have suspected, or now proven, jade artifacts from St. Vincent, Virgin Islands, Dominican Republic, and Cuba in the Head Collection. As an archaeologist, I couldn't say for certain if it was jade or not, but I could notice that we had all these magnificent axes, highly polished and slightly green or very green. And then I suspected it would be jade or nephrite. There was also the lapidary artifacts, not so common as the axes or the adzes. And I had some problems to utilize them in my research. So I also got hold of Katharina Gutto-Falsi, from Leiden, to get her to help me out, and we joined in this project, as she is doing the useware analysis of the artifacts. The first step, though, was to go down to France, to Pierre Petrakan. Lasse introduced me to him, and Pierre and Michel Herrera, they offered to do Raymond and microscopic inspection of selected jade artifacts. And of course, Raymond is not a 100% sure method, but it's given a high probability of that you know what you have in your collection. And that was kind of interesting. And now this is preliminary research and preliminary conclusions from Pierre and Michelle. So don't say that I said this was certain, but in their opinion, there's no nephrite in the hat collection. There's only jadeite. They think these artifacts that have been identified as nephrite by hat was also very good at identifying stuff just macroscopic. They think it's very pure jadeite. So for example, this frog pendant in the middle, which I long suspected to be a fake because it was so unique. He said this, in his opinion and Michelle's opinion, then this is jadeite, jade frog, and not nephrite. He just thinks it's very pure jadeite. That's interesting. But as I said, it's preliminary conclusion, so don't say, but Casper said, you said so. No, he said, this is what we think so far. The axis, also, it was a little bit dangerous to say that this is from the Caribbean, because in Denmark we have a little unfortunate history of thinking that jadeite axis, European jadeite axis, were imports from the Caribbean. And for example, this axe over here, where you see there's a start of a drilled hole, looked very much like some of the European axes. So that was also a thing we wanted to try to separate, if it was possible. But luckily, we can now say that this is in fact a Caribbean axe, and it's not something we've mixed up. It was also after Alice had a look at it with Garrett Davis. It's also quite clear that there was now very high likelihood of that we had a lot of jade artifacts in the collection. And this is just samples from the different islands in the Virgin Islands. We see up here the top one. It's been reused as grinder and hammerstone, like Sebastian also said. We have these very elaborate axes that are very polished. We have these with slightly asymmetrical bit end. And then we have one here that's, in my opinion, is very interesting, because if you look at the edge here, then it's really, really finely polished. And when I looked at it, I thought they were just finishing the axe. But Hat had written in the diary, now it's been repegged, the surface here. And this bit end was in fact the original. And I didn't believe him, but then Peter Kahn also said, well, this is the same as we see in Papua New Guinea. They call it washing the axe. So that was quite an interesting discovery that I was wrong, and had 100 years before had almost got it completely right. And then, of course, we had these lapidary artifacts that I also had some problems to use, but I'll get into that, or Katerina will get into that later, so to speak. Then there was also access from an artifacts from other islands, because we had this donations from other people. And it was quite interesting that we had a couple of axes, like more than 100 years ago, that were donated to the National Museum of Denmark. And they have a slightly different shape, these two Cuban axes. They are slightly conical in the butt end. Of course, we only have two, so it's a very small sample to say anything about. But at least here, the St. Vincent axe that we found looks more like the Virgin Island axes that we have in the collection. And we have at least 300 jadeite axes, I would say, in the National Museum's collections, both complete and reused. And then we also have from Dominican Republic, but that has not been part of the study so far, because that would just have killed me in my research if I tried to do that as well. I hope it's okay with Alistair, but this is one you gave to me. And here we see Alice and Garrett's setup in Copenhagen when they're sampling. We see we have an artifact here on the laser ICP-MS. And then we see up here on the screen, you see the bladed area on the artifact. And that's approximately 1 microsquare millimeter. That we see up there. That's what's getting lasered at the moment. So even on pristine artifacts like these, we could in fact get permission to do it, which was a little bit of a persuasive effort to get that permission. But I would say it's a very good method, because afterwards you cannot see the ablative area. You cannot feel it. You have to use at least 10 and more like 20 times magnification to see the ablative area. And then it shows up as a very distinct circular hole, which is kind of very different from natural indentations. So you can actually see it if you want to say this is where they laser and this is natural. So now I'm very looking forward to hearing the last on the other in the future here on the separation of the Virgin Island artifacts, because that would be significant if we can in fact say where they come from. Then Katharina Gutsjø-False, she also came to Copenhagen from Leiden to look at the lapidary artifacts. Now they have a slightly different history, because much of our lapidary Caribbean material is in fact collected by amateur archaeologists that lived on the islands and donated to the National Museum, often on the suggestion of Gudmund Hatt in 1923. A lot of this has been suspected of being from the early ceramic age, and I'm not. This is what Katharina has prepared, so I'm not going to go into arguing with that. But it looks like on recent ceramic analysis with the thermoluminescence that there is a problem with the way we are dating the ceramics, which might also have implication for how we have put the lapidary artifacts into what time slots we put them into, or what periods and ages. But normally, it's been like Katharina has presented on the slide here, we have the early ceramic age lapidary networks. They circulate around in the Caribbean. All these are from finds on St. Croix, especially from a place called Prosperity and Spread Hall. And we see they have a lot of different materials that are not found on the island, so they have to be traded in some way or exchanged in some way. As you can see, a lot of different materials. As I said before, the two major sites where there's material, lapidary materials, are Prosperity and Spread Hall, which is on up here on the western part of St. Croix. They show a strong similarity with the lapidary artifacts that have been found on the island of Vieques, which is a small, long island there, close to Puerto Rico, where there's two significant type sites called La Hueca and Salce. And they have a strong similarity. Unfortunately, as I said before, a lot of the ornaments or the lapidary in the Hatt collection are in fact artifacts that come from Gustav Norby's donations. And he gave three different big donations to the National Museum, one without almost any information in 1920. Just said St. Croix or the Caribbean. Then Hatt and his wife came around and said, we need to know at least the plantation, something like that. So there we have a little bit more information. And then in 1946, he gave a lot more mixed material. Katharina, she sampled or examined 65 ornaments, of which there was 33 beads, 29 pendants, and three non-perforated discs. And the material is as shown here, jadeite, plutonic rocks, phyrtonite, calcite, jasper, malachite, quartz, amethyst, and high pressure also plutonic rocks, and then some indeterminates. Because it's collected by this, there's no dipper charge and no unmodified materials. That Katerina has from other sites in the Caribbean, but not in this from the head collection. Then she has done a low and high magnification of the artifacts. She tried to assess the biographies of the objects, chain repertoire, technical states, production techniques, toolkits, use wear, recycling through these microscopic examinations. That's Katerina, see now with the microscope in Copenhagen. And then she had, for me, some very nice finds that she could see some of the techniques they've used, both for reducing the rock, the planar convex beads. It used like she concluded they have used flaking. Some of the other they have used snapping techniques, and some of the artifacts have in fact broken during production. So she's also been able to prove almost. And then there are some techniques that are a little bit more unusual, and especially on this frog painting, where it also looks like there's been sawing and drilling. So this was a nice add-on to our knowledge about the head collection, especially the lapidary, because this was something we were completely unaware of before. And this strongly suggests that there must have been a quite extensive trade network in the Eastern Caribbean. Other examinations of very rare objects like percury teeth or dog tooth pendants and so on also suggest there's been some connections down to South America and maybe to the foothills of the Andes. But this is a very rare objects, and to what extent there's been this exchange is difficult to say. Katerina's primary conclusion is that the ornament production took place locally, but if the blanks or the preforms came from the source areas, she cannot conclude that. The most common ornament types are very similar to those found in lapidary workshops in Puerto Rico, and I know she's also looked down to the southeast to Granada. So that's significant that she says there's more similarities to here. That was also what I would expect from a strictly archaeological point of view. But now it's say it's a more solid base, we can argue this. Then there's something that's a little bit strange, in my opinion, but you find there's a low presence of ornament in quartz, which suggests contacts with the south was restricted. There is quartz in the head collection, but not so much here in the lapidary, which is a bit strange. And then her conclusion is also that jadeite is not treated differently from other greenstones rock materials, such as jasper, serpentinite, malachite, and even calcite, as we have on the top, where we have some artifacts we call patrician lapidary artifacts. And the important is that, as far as we know, all the materials are not to be found on the Virgin Islands, so everything has to come from somewhere else, which is of course important for understanding of their society. It's also interesting that even though there's different materials, it's made into the same type of ornaments and using similar production technologies. The one exception is this frog-shaped pendant, which I originally thought might be a fake, which has a, as Katerina says, a more naturalistic depiction, and has been produced using more sophisticated techniques that's not observed on other artifacts of the head collection in Copenhagen. To sum it up, in my opinion, of all these inputs I've gotten and what I've seen myself and other research I've been doing, I tend now to maybe agree more with Sebastian that maybe these jadeite artifacts are more closely associated with a later ceramic age than early on. And for sure they had extensive networks, and also with South America and the foothills of the Andes. But to what extent is very difficult to say. I think it's been very limited from what we can see right now. And then also research I've done into with thermoluminescence of ceramics suggests that there's some problems with our original dating, I would argue. But that's something that's not related to jade. But then it's very clear that Alice's research with Garrett Davis, if they can argue well for this is from the Dominican Republic, that would up the scale again for having extensive long-range contacts. Because when we look at the axis, one of the conclusions I had is, and I think Tom will argue this later, so I'll only touch this very briefly, but it looks like there's almost been a mail order. I need these axes, this size, this and number, and then they've been exported to St. Croix and other islands, because there's a strong similarity between some of the axes. It's almost like a cache of when we see here in Europe, we see Bronze Age, we see celts, we find these caches are all the same. I can see almost the same in some of the sites in St. Croix especially. So I'll say I've become wiser during my research with Alice and Tom and Katerina and so on, but I also still have a lot of questions, which I hope we will solve in the near future. Thank you very much.